David Miles. I'm a professor of economics at Imperial College. And until a short while ago, I was at the Bank of England on the Monetary Policy Committee. And what I want to talk about is this, well, it's the financial sector and the wider economy, but maybe say some specific things about Brexit, the potential impact upon Brexit on the financial sector, and the knock-on impact of that upon the wider economy and what it might do to households and the non-financial corporate sector. There are different estimates about how big the financial services sector is in the UK. I think there are just over a million people. Some people think it's as high as 1.3 million people working in financial services. Financial services probably, in aggregate, the wide definition of financial services, contribute somewhere a little bit short of 10% to UK GDP. That makes the financial sector about the same size as the manufacturing sector. Most of the people, however, that working in banks, I think nearly all the people that work in the pension sector, the majority of people in the insurance sector, which are the really big employers in the financial services sector, are actually providing services to UK households and UK companies. So in the context of Brexit, although it sort of seems very worrying that the financial services sector is as big roughly as the manufacturing sector, and maybe it's going to be significantly affected by Brexit, actually the proportion of people and I think also the proportion of value added that's created in the financial services sector as a result of its interaction with the European Union, in particular exports to the European Union, is much smaller than you might think. I think it's difficult to be precise on what the scale of exports from the financial services sector to the rest of the EU is. I've seen some estimates that are between 20 and 25 billion. Most of them are a bit higher than that, somewhere between 25 and 30 billion. Not a trivial number, clearly, but probably of the order of 1.5%, maybe slightly under 1.5% of GDP. So even if you were very pessimistic about the impact of the UK leaving the EU, you thought that financial services would no longer get passporting rights and it would be more difficult to sell stuff into the European Union. And suppose you took the view that that was going to cut exports in half, which I think is pretty pessimistic, given that there may be arrangements to do with equivalence of regulation, which means that even outside the single market, it may not dramatically affect exports to the rest of the EU. But supposing you thought it would cut them in half, you're talking about losing something of the order of 0.7% of 0.7% of GDP, 0.7 of 1% of GDP. So to state the blindingly obvious, the idea that this means that the UK would be descending into a black hole of economic failure is, to put it mildly, woefully wide of the mark. Nonetheless, might the UK not lose crucial bits of infrastructure that are essential to the wider economy, and the impact of which is not particularly well measured by just looking directly at exports to the EU? Which of course prompts the question, what is crucial for the wider economy from the financial sector? I think four things. Firstly, that the financial sector operates the payment system, and if that didn't work, there'd be a disaster pretty quickly. Secondly, it helps people manage wealth over their lives and smooth out differences between income and consumption in obvious ways through provision of pensions and savings products. Capital allocation, that is channeling savings to investment spending ultimately. A crucial role, I think, in the housing sector, actually not so crucial, frankly, for the financing of investment by the non-financial corporate sector in the UK. And I'll very briefly show you some numbers that illustrate that in a moment. And finally, risk management. Well, obviously, the insurance sector, that's the primary role of the insurance sector. But there's a sort of wider definition of risk management where other companies, not just insurance companies, play a role. Are any of those critical functions likely to be dramatically impacted by Brexit? I rather doubt it. Let me focus on one issue, first of all, which is the provision of funds to finance investment in the non-financial corporate sector. So this chart, I hope you can see it, shows the total level of investment by the non-financial corporate sector in the UK. These are percentages of GDP. That's the yellow line. Internal funds, i.e. the proportion of that investment that in aggregate anyway is financed by companies simply not paying out profits and using it to fund capital expenditure, is the blue line. And you'll see that since, well, for about 10 years actually, companies have not net...
David, that's five there.
Oh, is that gone? All right, I'll be very quick. Can I have 2 minutes? Can I have two?
One.
Maybe people might have access to any slides later. This just backs up the point that actually internally generating funds are the most important bit for most companies in the UK, and that most of the overall lending of the banking sector in the UK is financed out of deposits which largely come from UK households. So my guess is, sort of cutting straight to the bottom line really, my guess is that the costs on the wider economy of the UK not having access to the single market, which does affect the financial services sector, is actually easy to exaggerate, and I suspect it is not a first order magnitude. There are some minor benefits to being outside. You can avoid some rules which are frankly rather silly. It's very silly that the capital requirements directive is maximum harmonization, so that in principle not only can regulators in the UK not allow UK banks to have less capital than in other places, neither can they, in principle, have more capital, which is a ridiculous piece of legislation. I think there's also rather unhelpful things to do with bonuses. But the main point I'll leave you with, and I'll finish on this, my overall message really is that the impact on the wider economy of Brexit's impact on the financial services sector is easy to exaggerate, and I suspect is not that big.
Thank you.
My name is Peter Smith. I lead a firm in East London called Blockchain. We're the largest sort of scaled out production platform for any sort of blockchain technology software in the world. We have an interesting perspective on a lot of this because most of our business is outside the UK. But it doesn't actually impact us in terms of market access. The thing that really impacts us as a business that I worry about with the Brexit is talent. And so there's something that very few people in, I think, in the policy community or in the academic community or even in the finance community understand about sort of the future of work and the future of sort of building strong economies. Which is that as a engineer, as a technologist, we sort of know that we're only as good as our ability to recruit really, really exceptional technical talent. And this is a numbers game. So to build truly category-leading technology companies, you need the top 1% of technical talent. And so a lot of my job is focused around how do I recruit for our firm the top 1%. What separates us with our large market position from some of our competitors is just sheerly the talent that we have under our roof. So what really worries me about the Brexit is its long-term impact on recruiting top technology talent into London in specific and into the rest of the UK more generally. So it's a, like I said, a raw numbers game. If you're recruiting 1% of the top 1% of the UK population versus recruiting the top 1% of the European population, you have a very, very different talent pool that you're drawing from. And historically, the model for technology companies in London, truly elite ones like DeepMind, like Facebook, like Amazon, like us, has been that we recruit most of our technical talent, nearly, I would say the majority of it, from mainland Europe. But these engineers want to move to London because London's seen as a stronger economy. It's seen as the place where the best and brightest go to work. So that's shifting now, because it's starting to be perceived that the UK has an anti-European outlook, an anti-immigrant outlook. And what we're seeing instead is people using Berlin and Amsterdam as alternatives. And so for the first time ever, the last two quarters in a row, financial technology companies in New York and Berlin individually outraised the London market, which is a huge, huge market shift. And a lot of that comes down to long-term thoughts about where you're going to be able to recruit talent. And so I think that's, for me, the biggest worry when it comes to Brexit, is that irregardless of what the government does specifically with immigration policies, and I think that there's a lot that can be done to encourage immigration, particularly high-skilled immigration, that if there's this sort of sentiment, this market sentiment that we can't quantify, but it's intangible, that London's no longer the place where the best and brightest from Europe want to come and work and live, that you're not going to be able to build truly elite technology companies in London anymore. And that instead of building them in London, you're going to build them in Berlin, and you're going to build them in Amsterdam, probably Berlin. Our engineering team has two British people in it. Two. And we have dozens of engineers. And so if we sort of allow this market sentiment to continue to pervade, even if we fix the immigration system, which is deeply, deeply flawed and broken, it's going to be a huge, huge long-term knock-on effect. The other thing that I'll talk about that I think is a big risk is investors' long-term capital commitments. Most capital in the technology sector, even the financial technology sector, is not from the UK. So of the tens and tens and tens of millions of dollars that our firm has raised, we've raised $2 million from the UK. So our cap table is tiny from the United Kingdom and even smaller from Europe. So most of this capital is coming from the United States or increasingly from Hong Kong. Investors are panicked about the long-term future of the UK as a technology center. A lot of it comes back to the point that I made about talent. A lot of it comes back to market access. But it's even bigger, comes down to this fear of uncertainty. So as an entrepreneur, as a business person, you can deal with almost anything except uncertainty. And so I think that another really long-term risk here is that the UK doesn't recover its status as a place where venture capital wants to be invested. And these businesses are very, very expensive to build, and British venture capitalists don't have the risk appetite, or quite frankly, the funds under management to finance the truly transformative tech companies that are necessary to generate real, real jobs and real sort of economic activity. The last thing I'll say, because I think I'm running almost out of time, is that I think that Brexit actually represents a huge opportunity. And so I wasn't as anti-Brexit or really had an opinion either way. I've been here for 9 years now. I think that there's a lot of opportunities in the Brexit for the government to put in very sensible policies, particularly around immigration, around job creation, around corporate tax rates. But I think what we've seen is we've seen that there's been a lot of sentiment, a lot of which has been encouraged by the government, like, for example, asking for lists of foreign employees, that's created this fear, this uncertainty, and this sentiment that London isn't going to use this opportunity to grow, to expand, to seize the opportunity. It's going to use it to put up walls and to cut itself out of Europe. And I think that's really dangerous. And so I think that, you know, if we can, if the government can reorient a lot of that market sentiment, I think it's an incredible opportunity. But in the meantime, I think it's a huge amount of risk on the private sector, particularly the technology sector.
We have Jenny Tooth. Jenny, please.
Yes, thank you. I'm Jenny Tooth. I'm Chief Executive of the UK Business Angels Association. And for those of you less familiar with Business Angels, these are private individuals who put their own money and time and expertise in backing small businesses in the UK and around the world. And it's also worth noting that business angel investment and your investment from private investors is the most significant source of risk capital in this country. One of the challenges at the moment is that last year we raised £1.8 billion, or over 3,000 small businesses, by backing small businesses using the government's great tax schemes that we have for private investors in this country. The Enterprise Investment Scheme and Seed Enterprise Investment Scheme have enabled us to build a wall of private sector capital to build small businesses. Clearly, Brexit is a challenge for many private investors who at this time have used a significant proportion of their own spare financial capacity to back small businesses. And there is a need, obviously, to ensure that that uncertainty post-Brexit that may be affecting their other parts of their investment capacity, such as property and stocks and shares, is not going to prevent them to continue to back small businesses. So this is a really significant issue for us, that we continue to be able to support private investment, that we continue to offer those tax breaks and indeed loosen some of those tax breaks in view of the fact that many of them are considerably restricted by state aid at this moment. There are opportunities in Brexit around that. I totally endorse the issue about talent and access to talent. The investment community will say that this is one of the most significant areas of threat to the growth and success of small businesses going forward to enable them to scale up. And since so much of that talent has been accessed internationally, as we witnessed now in this previous speech, it's very important that this part of our government strategy is sorted out to give certainty in that market. A third aspect of the whole market for us is that obviously startups have to scale, and one of the biggest challenges is a lack of strong and vibrant venture capital funds in this country. Over 30% of it is actually currently dependent on the EIF, European Investment Fund, and the European Investment Bank to actually build those venture capital funds in this country. Therefore, the loss of that money that we may well experience post-Brexit is very worrying indeed. And we are awaiting the government's strategy on this, although we do know that the British Business Bank is going to be strengthened and that there are some new funds being put on the table. But there is certainly a long way to go to give that kind of certainty. It's also worth remembering that this is even more important outside London and the South East. At the moment, 63% of early stage capital actually is backing small businesses in London and the South East, particularly London, Cambridge and Oxford. And yet, at this moment, it is the other regions outside London that will be most affected by the loss, by Brexit, the affected by their economy, and therefore the need to bolster funds for those areas is absolutely vital. The most significant issue for us is that we need a strong and connected supply of finance, both from start-up, but most importantly, to support scale-up. And whilst we've been extremely successful in building startup capital, we've dismally been able to build real scale-up capital. And this was also touched on in the previous speech. At the moment, America has four times more availability of later stage capital than we have in this country. And we are losing so many of our businesses out to the US. You will have already heard about Arm. We recently also had acquisition by Skyscanner, by Citicorp from China, SwiftKey also from Japanese SoftBank. So these are tremendous challenges for us. We do have a huge opportunity to build the pension and private institution backing of venture capital in this country. Our government is putting on a review called Patient Capital Review. There is an urgent need to both loosen regulations, to provide incentives, and to really encourage far more of this money to come into our funds. We've seen some significant corporates starting to build funds in this country. Indeed, we are attracting international capital. But we need to have a strong environment and a strong framework in which both personal pensions and institutional money can continue to build that finance. So my whole point today is that we have to have a connected supply of finance, not just at startup, but right through to scale up, if we are going to build great global businesses and retain our position as leaders in technology, but also growth. And I think this is an urgent issue that we need to address today.
I'll go quickly through what I'm going to say and about the four main concerns we have about Brexit, which are listed there. And in fact, spelt out there. I'll start by just saying, well, why should you care about our industry sector? The first presentation covered finance more generally. I'm going to talk about that part of finance which our members do, and that is professionally managing other people's money, and that is savers' money in whatever form, whether it's collective investment in funds such as ISAs or pension savings, and indeed institutional money more generally. The key stats are up there on the slide. I'll just point out just a couple of things about us. I mean, the EU is a very significant market for us, both in terms of the source of the money we manage, and that's around about 1.2 trillion of the 5.7 trillion sterling of money entrusted to our 200 or so members by savers is from EU27, that's i.e. ex-UK savers. So disruption to that supply of money is obviously a major concern for us. And we are a very substantial export earner within the financial services sector. We're not a heavy people industry in the same way as banking, but the people in our industry generate a lot of money, including a lot of export earnings for the nation and a lot of tax also for the nation. And in relation to those sorts of stats, not just for our industry, but for finance more generally, I'd point you towards the Citi UK. Citi UK has done tons of work on the numbers, on the money, which is at stake here. I'll just do a couple of slides to show you what, pictorially, what's at stake in terms of market access. And by market access, I mean that 1.2 trillion. Will we still be able to manage it from businesses here in the UK? This is the current situation with the EU, with the UK as a member of the EU. The passport, which you hear all about, which comes with membership of the EU, enables us to do business on a green light, i.e. no problem basis at the moment. This would be the situation if the UK has a hard Brexit, to use some of the jargon, i.e. the UK ends up in the same position as the US or Japan, say. That's a dramatic change in the terms of access to those markets. And just to show you in an even more complicated picture what the situation is for collective investment, that's funds. That's when mums and dads put money into funds to save for the future, whether it's for retirement or for big savings. ISAs are the typical vehicle in this country, but not the only one, of course. I won't go through that diagram, but it just shows you the complexity of what's at stake and the many parts of this puzzle which are under threat, potentially, from the UK's exit from the EU. And the next slide is a similar one into the hedge fund and indeed VC and private equity collective products. So that's the situation of market access. The second concern we have is more generally in relation to what happens to the International Financial Centre. The last speaker talked about we need finance from startup through scale up, right through the life cycle. We are part of that system. We bring 5.7 trillion of savings and turn it into investments. Now, necessary for us to do that is a thriving financial system, viable capital markets, and that also is a concern for us, what might happen to that as a result of Brexit. One example only is that both the President of France and the Finance Minister of Germany have said that euro-denominated clearing must leave London and return to the eurozone. Now, whether that threat will be delivered on or not remains to be seen, but if it is delivered on, that takes out one of the pieces of the cluster of the financial centre which the UK has, alongside New York, the only two global financial centres on the planet, with unknown consequences. And that's just one threat Brexit has given rise to. And I'll just show you pictorially, again, the complexity we're talking about. This is in relation to equities and the players in the trading of shares, including ourselves at the center. And that's for derivatives, which gets even more complicated, and showing also the role of clearing, which is one of the more vulnerable nodes in the financial sector.
Angus, that's 5 minutes.
Good, I'll just another 30 seconds. We have two other priorities. Talent, I won't reiterate what all the other speakers have said, vitally important for us as well, absolutely key. And the last one is we need to avoid the cliff, which you will have read about as well. That really does matter. If the terms of trade, if the access to the market changes from the status quo, then we need some sort of orderly transition to whatever the future will be. And that's it. Thank you very much.
So to introduce myself, I'm a partner of Wyman in the financial services practice. And as Angus said, City UK have put a lot of numbers out there, and actually Oliver Wyman supported the City UK in producing those numbers. So what I wanted to do today is provide a little bit of insight as to that work, but then, and I have a few slides which are exhibits from a report we put out publicly, and that's available on our website for those interested if you want a little bit more detail. But then I wanted to also turn that into a discussion of growth opportunities. This is indeed the Growth Commission. So we started some work for the City UK immediately after Brexit, and the purpose of that work was to develop a fact base on what the potential impact of Brexit could be on the financial services sector. There were three steps involved in that process. The first was to define at least what is the size of the UK financial services sector today in terms of revenue, tax, GVA, and employment. The second one was to say, well, let's think through the scenarios of what could happen. The purpose of the report very explicitly wasn't to define what the scenarios should be and what policymakers should look at, but rather to provide a set of outcomes that should be considered. And then finally, to quantify, firstly, the direct impact of Brexit, and then secondly, what we term the ecosystem impact of other areas of financial services. And I'll come on to talk about those shortly. So this slide here says, well, how big is the financial services sector today? And we spent a lot of time getting together the best data that was available from public sources, from colleagues at the ABI, the BBA, and the Investment Association to really mine all those databases and come up with the best robust view of how big the financial services sector is today, tied back to public numbers wherever possible. And then the key challenge was to break it down into component parts to determine, you know, what bits might be at risk versus those that are very domestic and therefore safe. And this exhibit shows you, the headlines are, the financial services sector today in the UK creates about 200 billion of revenue. You can see we then broke that down to international business and deeply domestic business. As colleagues pointed out earlier, a lot of the domestic business is not so much a direct impact of Brexit. The macroeconomic environment around that will be mostly impacted. Our report didn't cover that. We simply said, you know, that's the domestic piece of the business. And what we focused on was, well, what happens to that international component? And we really defined three scenarios along a spectrum. The first one was, well, not much changes. We get full passporting and equivalence, and therefore, what would the impact of that be? And then we had a middle way, which was equivalence where the provision already exists. And I won't go into the details here. I've got 5 minutes. It's a very technical thing, and I could talk for hours on it. But effectively, it's a bit of a halfway house where we get no special treatment, but we at least get some equivalence agreements that we could expect reasonably, given the rule book is effectively the same today. It's hard for a rational person to say we're not equivalent when we have the same rules, but we're not always in a rational world, as we know. And then finally, what happens in a third country agreement where we have nothing at all, and in effect we leave the EU with no agreements in place whatsoever? We did suggest some sensible things around data provision, given their global agreements, some things around the asset management industry where portfolio management can be delegated across the UK, and we also assumed some international cooperation agreements that we have in place today as a result of being in the EU that would continue. They're not a given, but we felt like we needed to draw a line somewhere to make some sensible assumptions, and so that's what we did. So what are the impacts? Well, in the high access scenario, we saw, you know, some frictional costs, if you like, a few banks moving no regret people, a few asset managers moving people around, but effectively pretty de minimis impact. And if you think about the fluctuations of financial services, employment and revenue over a period of time, that's pretty normal and pretty manageable in the high access scenario. But what you see in the low access scenario is a much bigger impact. And in this scenario, we estimated that the first order conditions, so things that just legally would need to be done elsewhere, so no big shifts in financial services patterns, but just some person serving an EU client in the UK can just no longer do that in this scenario. It's illegal. They would necessarily need to move. And so we estimated that first order impact. And I'll talk in terms of jobs because it's a bit more tangible. So in terms of jobs, we said 31 to 35,000 financial services jobs would move. But then, realistically, when you're reorienting a business, you don't just move the minimal, you move bits that are adjacent to that. So some of the risk management function related to that European business might necessarily need to move. And so if you add that in to all of the numbers, you get about a doubling in terms of jobs, tax, and GVA and revenue. So up to 75,000 jobs at risk overall as a result of the ecosystem impact. Now, could that impact be much smaller? Yes, we did this during summer. The banks and the asset managers and the insurers are still working through their plans. And therefore, institution by institution, plans will move. This is an estimate, it could be lower. But on the same token, I could quickly design a scenario in which this is much, much higher. And so it's a point in time estimate to put a stake in the ground. But what is very true is the first order condition there is just a legal must, and that number is pretty hard baked. It's the ecosystem number that might move around depending on what firms ultimately do. So what does that mean for growth? If you listen to people who believe strongly in Brexit, they would say, well, that's all very well, but what about the opportunities? India. And I would just, my end point would be, well, the opportunities in the high access scenario, the ecosystem is still in London, it's unchanged. It's going to be much harder to harness those opportunities in a world where we've lost a lot of jobs already and the nexus of the financial services sector has moved away from London. Thank you.
Thank you, Nick. My name is Adam Jackson. I'm Head of Public Affairs at Grant Thornton. I'm joined by my colleague David Morrey from our financial services practice. And when we come on to questions, we've got questions around what we're really hearing from clients day in, day out. David is the man to ask, but I'll do the presentation. At Grant Thornton, I just wanted to give a brief bit of context, I suppose to show the alignment with the Growth Commission as a whole. Our purpose is to shape a vibrant economy, and we're working with our own Vibrant Economy Commission to define that. And crucially, I think linking with Nick's comments about wider sustainability, we see a vibrant economy as being more than GDP growth. So this just illustrates a piece of work we're doing around how you measure a balanced economy. As part of that, we're working with the RSA, specifically to look at the impact of technology on financial services. So I'll draw on a little of that work. But more generally, as a firm, we work with a range of clients in financial services across all of the sectors you've heard today, insurance, banking, investment management, and also the regulators. So that includes regulatory advice, investigations, internal audit, and broader consultancy on things like leadership and culture. And since July, we've been working as well in advising clients on Brexit, and that's something I've been quite involved in. The key point I think that we'd make based on those discussions with the industry are financial services in the city are facing big challenges. They were facing big challenges before Brexit, and actually Brexit simply accelerates or compounds those. And in turn, in thinking about Brexit, what's really key, I think, for government, for policymakers, and for the industry, is to develop a really clear, compelling, future-focused vision of the city that can then help shape the approach to Brexit. So if we look at the challenges being faced, trust has been an issue since 2008. It's shaped the government's approach to the city, but it's created a deep-seated, box-ticking culture and a kind of regulatory tsunami. Looking ahead, technology has the scope to build trust, but also to create new issues around trust, which in turn will drive more regulatory change. But technology can aid new consumer behaviors. We're seeing that already. We're kind of possibly only at the start of the journey around the transformation that will drive. It increases risks around cybersecurity. Technology will create significant job losses in financial services as we see things like robot advice, artificial intelligence driving efficiency in the sector. So we can see probably that the jobs in the sector will decline regardless of Brexit. It's important to note that established financial services face these technology issues on the back of very old legacy IT systems where they kind of layer additional technology as it comes on stream. That, for established firms, creates challenges in terms of resilience, efficiency, and agility. I think, finally, we're seeing kind of global shift from the city to Asia. Some of the financial services follow the burgeoning middle-class consumer markets there. Now, Brexit, as we've heard, creates additional uncertainty. It creates issues around the regulatory environment and access to markets, and crucially also around access to talent. I think what we see is that in different financial services, sectors and subsectors, and even firms within those, are affected in different ways. So the change won't be uniform, but also what we're seeing is it actually Brexit itself is driving a review of those firms' strategy, which takes account of some of these broader issues. What this does is create an opportunity to redefine the city and redefine financial services in the UK. In ways that could create a distinctive approach in the global market, could create greater agility and continued relevance, particularly through greater innovation, and could connect financial services with wider society, which could kind of boost resilience. So we set out four areas, and these are ones where the seeds are already planted. This doesn't come kind of completely anew. There is work already underway that policymakers and the industry could build on. So firstly, rediscovering a sense of purpose. So going beyond financial markets as a purely speculative tool. We're seeing that with people like Old Mutual taking a purpose-driven approach around responsible investment. There's an opportunity to build on the Bank of England's work on productive capital data to strengthen that focus. So the focus that John Kay picked out as the purpose of industry, and could really drive thinking for the future. Linked to that is building a long-term outlook. Again, we have people like Hermes looking at a longer-term approach to investment management. Others, Jenny and others, have talked about how we incentivize institutional and pension funds to invest in business growth. At Grant Thornton, we're working with an organization called Future Fit around how we can develop a new reporting standards for the triple bottom line of profit, people, and planet, how that can then play into decisions about, for example, investment of personal pensions. I think linked to all of that is innovation, and we would see it as really crucial that in its Brexit strategy, the government prioritises maintaining the UK as the fintech centre of the world, which I think illustrates Peter's points. That also means developing a regulatory approach that supports innovation. The FCA is doing some good work around RegTech and innovation, and really that just needs to go further and faster. And finally, a focus on people and culture. Again, Peter mentioned talent. There's an opportunity to build on Jane Ann Gardier's Women in Finance report for government. The Banking Standards Board is looking at culture. When we go into banks to address compliance issues on the behalf of regulators, what we usually see at the root cause is not a failure of processes, it's usually a failure of leadership and culture. Banks know that, they want to focus on it, they need a little bit more space and incentivization to do that. So in summary, I think don't focus on kind of the current state of financial services markets, think about the factors that are changing them already and where that change leads to. And in doing so, there's an opportunity to build a vision, and I think it's really important to engage with people to create a vision for a more innovative, purposeful city that builds both trust and attracts talent and investment.
Thanks, Nick. I'm Hugh Evans. I'm the Director General of the Association of British Insurers, which is the main trade body representing the breadth of the insurance and long-term savings industry. Very happy to contribute and delighted that insurance is near the end of the batting order, leaving the best till last. In terms of the contribution of insurance to growth, I'll just make a few general points and then talk specifically about Brexit. And clearly, I'd hope we all understand that a mature insurance system is essential to any sophisticated economy and is a vital facilitator of growth, helping businesses expand by enabling them to safely manage their risks and attract investment, protecting the individual assets that accrue in a successful economy, both for entrepreneurs, employers, investors, and employees, helping employers and employees with liability and critical illness challenges, and of course ensuring that work builds up long-term savings for employees and for the economy in which those assets are then invested. And we're pretty good at this in this country. We're the fourth largest insurance market in the world, the largest in the European Union. We employ over 300,000 people, two-thirds of them outside of London, and the ONS values our contribution to the economy at around 35 billion. So the UK has principally got an insurance and long-term savings market that is well established to support growth, underpinned by London being the insurance capital of the world. But we face some headwinds. Political uncertainty has already been mentioned, particularly important in a business that writes a lot of long-term contracts. The digital revolution poses its challenges, but also its opportunities. Some wider societal challenges, most obviously an aging society, pose quite profound issues for the long-term savings sector and for policymakers. And there are some competitiveness headwinds as well. IPT going up three times in 18 months, some of the corporate losses reforms which catch insurers in their web, and some of the regulatory challenges that have hit the insurance industry following the financial crisis. So where does that leave us in relation to Brexit and our ability both to find opportunities in Brexit but also to deal with the challenges? Well, firstly, what's the sort of scale of the issue, which has obviously been a debate already here today? Within the insurance sector, I think it's clear to say that those firms that are heavily active in the EU, many of them do use passporting, and for those firms that use insurance firms that use passporting, it matters a huge amount. The ABI estimates, having worked with our members on surveys, that £3.6 billion of premiums are written in London using passporting, and that covers both the general insurance side primarily, particularly on the commercial and wholesale side, but also some long-term savings companies which use passporting, and of course the reinsurance part of the economy, which heavily relies on passporting to move money in and out. But it's also the case, as Professor Miles noted, that many UK firms are indeed just UK only. But for them, the significance of Europe matters in terms of the regulatory environment, access to skills and people, and of course data, and the data framework that applies across Europe, which is absolutely critical to the insurance industry. And that's why our asks of government in terms of the Brexit negotiations have focused on those areas, have looked for as much access to the single market as is possible, but also that can be achieved in a timely manner. Because for insurance firms that are taking decisions about domicile in the next year, it's no good reaching a great deal at the 11th hour when they've already taken their decision and relocated their people. We're looking for a regulatory environment which is as convergent as possible, maintaining the benefits that we have at the moment, and we are not interested, contrary to what the Treasury Select Committee thinks, in unravelling Solvency II. If you spent £4 billion implementing something, there's the only thing worse is spending £4 billion unimplementing it. We look for as identical a system on data as we can manage, and I'd echo the comments on labour and skills that have been made. So I think it's wise to look at the impact of Brexit on the insurance industry is not just about exports, but around the impact on London as an insurance market and the cluster effect that London and the UK more generally benefits from as a world-leading insurance sector. Final word on opportunities, primarily around trade. And a plea, I suppose, when we think of growth opportunities, to think of trade not just in terms of bumper deals, because we all know those are often focused on goods rather than services, and they take many years to negotiate. For the financial services world more generally, and particularly for insurance, opening up dialogue through free trade discussions and removing restrictions in emerging markets in Asia is the absolute sort of key growth opportunity for our sector. And we've identified eight countries, headed, no surprises, by India and China, where we see huge growth opportunities because of the growth of the middle class populations in those countries and the relative sophistication of the products we can offer them. So opportunities, but some big challenges, and certainly not a negligible impact on us going forward if we're to meet our traditional need of helping facilitate and develop growth in our economy.
Thank you, Hugh. Thanks very much. Charlie, please.
Thank you. Charlie Bean, professor at the London School of Economics these days, but formerly Deputy Governor of Monetary Policy at the Bank of England. A lot of what I might have said has already been said by other speakers, so I'm not going to repeat that, but rather just pick up on a few points. I think, just to start with some good news before I get on to bad news, firstly, I mean, David made the point that a lot of activity in the financial sector is actually domestically focused, and that will remain. I think also one needs to recognize that London's role as an international financial center is founded on a clutch of things: predictability of the legal system, English language, time zone halfway between the US and Asia, a generally sympathetic regulatory environment, critical mass of expertise both in finance and the ancillary services such as the law that support it, a tradition of openness to foreign firms and migrants, and earlier remarks about the importance of maintaining that I'd reinforce, the perceived integrity of London's markets and participants, although one has to recognize maybe that's taken a little bit of a hit from the financial crisis, and then a market infrastructure that supports high levels of financial activity. So a lot of sources of comparative advantage, and they're self-reinforcing, that generate what economists would refer to as agglomeration externalities. And that means it's quite difficult to dislodge activity. I think reinforcing that is the fact that there's no real competitor in the elsewhere in the European Union. You've got financial centres, but none of them are really global financial centres of to rival London. So that's a sort of optimistic starting point. However, I think it's clear that Brexit, unless current access arrangements are maintained, will imply potentially losing some activities at the margin. I think it's relatively unlikely that we will be able to preserve existing access through the single market and passporting regime. It seems to me unlikely that the other member states are going to agree to that in a world where we're going to want to have some controls on migration. So what are the consequences? As far as the retail end of activities go, it will require operators that presently are based in London but selling activities through branches in the rest of the EU would need to create subsidiaries where they don't already have them. A lot of the larger non-EU institutions that are based in banks, particularly I'm talking about here, that are based in London to access the European market already have those subsidiaries. So it wouldn't necessarily change legal structures, but smaller operations may need to. Now, Lindsey referred to, it's not the just the direct shift in personnel that might take place, but sort of the ecosystem. And that sort of implies it's the decision by the firms, which I think is true. But I think I'd add in an extra element, which is the role of what will now be the new home regulators in the European Union will be relevant here, that they may take a view about other activities that need to be relocated to support the subsidiary. So to give you a concrete example, when I was at the bank and we were discussing how we would handle Santander if it got into difficulties, there was an issue for us in that its underlying services, IT services and so forth, were provided by a separate company that was based in Spain. The question about whether that could operate successfully if the Santander parent got into difficulty. So regulators will have a view about activities that may need to relocate, as well as the firms. On the equivalence issue, which I suspect is where we will find ourselves, that we will be relying on access through various equivalence arrangements. First of all, these are related to the country, not the financial institution. You demonstrate the equivalence of your regulatory regime. At the moment, these third country access through equivalence, are that they apply to quite narrowly defined areas. They're policed by the European Commission. They draw on recommendations from the various European supervisory bodies, rulemaking bodies, but it's the European Commission that polices them, so inevitably it's a potentially politicized process. By definition, at the moment, the UK is equivalent in all of the relevant areas, since we're part of the single market with common.
That's 5 minutes.
Yeah, with common regulations and so forth. That means that there is an opportunity now, I think, to identify the key areas where we want equivalence in the negotiations. The key issue, of course, will be preserving that in the future, given the European Commission can withdraw equivalence at any time. And in practice, even though these are set up to be equivalence in terms of impact rather than line-by-line equivalence of rules, I suspect that it will mean we will have to follow EU regulations as they evolve in the future reasonably closely to preserve access through equivalence regimes. Just briefly on market infrastructure, which was touched on, this is an area where I think there is a high probability that we will end up using euro-denominated clearing. The European Central Bank did make the argument that for financial stability reasons, it was necessary that central clearing counterparties should be located in the Eurozone if they were clearing euro-denominated instruments. I don't think the economics of that makes sense. It's perfectly reasonable to have the CCP located in London. It may be clearing euros. It may need euro liquidity if there were problems, but they could be provided through swap arrangements to the Bank of England and so forth. Having said that, in practice, I think it's quite likely once we're outside that there may be a renewed attempt to shift those activities back into the Eurozone. Finally, just to finish up, what about the opportunities once we're outside? Some people do talk as though, well, there'll be an opportunity for a bonfire of regulations, and this will improve our competitiveness. That they made that remark in general, but also in relation to the city. I think one should recognize that most of the regulations that have been introduced in recent years are a consequence of international agreements, the implementation of Basel III, and other initiatives at the G20 level. They may have been implemented through EU regulations and directives, but the impetus has been at an international level. And the UK has actually often been in favor of stronger regulation than has been introduced. So I don't think people should be thinking in terms of gaining comparative advantage through significant financial deregulation. Rather, we should be looking to things like preserving openness, fostering entrepreneurship, and things like that. And I'll conclude there.
Thank you. Thank you very much to all our speakers. We have about 40 minutes for interaction questions. Can we, Richard? And could you start by saying who you are?
Hi there, my name is Richard Davis. I'm Chief of Staff of the Growth Commission. I think if everybody, when they ask their questions, could stand up, it helps the people doing the video. Something that has long interested me is a tension between two stories about the UK that we constantly hear. And I wondered if I could put them to the panel. It's kind of to David, Peter and Jenny, but any other comments would be helpful. One is that there's some sort of missing middle in British finance. You hear that we don't have mid-sized firms in the way Germany does, and you hear stories about that's because it's very it's easy to get startup capital, then difficult to get scale. But it's easy to get startup, difficult to get scale-up capital. I just somehow don't understand how that fits with the other story we're constantly told about Britain, is that we're an over-financialized economy, one of the most financialized economies in the world. So why do we have that gap? Is the first part of the question. And the second is, is it something that that's either going to be made worse by Brexit or that we can deal with outside of the EU?
Okay, I'm happy to make a start on this. And I did mention the issue about patient capital. Where we differ from, say, Germany at the moment, is that we have not actually developed those very long-term patient capital funds, as you will have with the Gründerfund and various institutions. And I think this is something that we are looking to deal with. What we also have, though, in this country has been an over-reliance on bank debt for growth of companies, as opposed to the use of risk capital. And you will see that all of the commentary that my colleagues make from the venture capital sector right through to the London Stock Exchange is that at the moment we have an undercapitalized country in terms of business finance when it comes to risk capital, and an over-reliance on bank debt. And what we haven't had is kind of very long-term patient funds. If you look back at the 3i model that we had many years ago, that was aimed at that. We have the Business Growth Fund, which the banks supported, $2.5 billion fund. But at this moment, we don't have that capital which enables a company to grow successfully long-term and not rely on external international capital to attain that growth, in which case we then lose them to the rest of the world. And I think that's where we have had our gap to date.
So this is actually a really interesting question. And I'm going to give my perspective, but it's important for me to sort of qualify that a bit. The first is that, you know, when we talk about venture capital and angel investing, I'd say that the vast majority of the businesses that your angels are investing in look nothing like my business. And so it's important to recognize that there's a lot of angel investing and, you know, risk capital that goes into building small and mid-cap businesses like you're talking about. And then there's high-tech firms. And it's particularly in what I work in, which is financial technology, this is very different. On the one side, it's very, very, very risky. On the other side, if you look at, you know, the top 10 companies in the world by market cap today, they're all companies that were financed with extremely high-risk venture capital from the high-tech industry. So if Britain wants to continue to grow, continue to be vibrant, continue to have huge, successful companies, it's going to have to figure this question out. Now, in my case, our business is full of a lot of ironies. It's probably the first time ever that a category-leading company was headquartered in London. So usually the UK tech scene has the number two company or the number three company, but they never really have the number one company. This is the first time that's ever happened. And it's been that way since the very early days, which leads to the logical conclusion that, you know, London venture capital would have been, you know, very eager to work with us. In the very early days, venture capital in London was completely uninterested in what we did because it was far too high risk. Instead, most of the early offers were from West Coast firms that wanted us to relocate to the West Coast when they would then finance our business. we decided that we'd rather figure out how to make money first, and we were lucky that a few of the co-founders of the business had already made money, so we could sink our own capital into it. But you have a lot of companies that do leave. A really famous example that we don't talk about in the UK, because it's embarrassing, is Stripe. Stripe's a $10 billion company today, that the only reason that they're in San Francisco and not in London is that the Collision brothers could only raise capital if they agreed to move to San Francisco. They got the same offer we did, and they made a different choice. That's $10 billion of, you know, activity. That's thousands and thousands of jobs that otherwise would have been here. So you make a great point about, you know, where is this scale-up capital that they're always talking about. There's two problems in London in the venture capital scene. One is that there's not enough of it, and that's started to be fixed, but the way that started to be fixed is in a lot of small funds. And so when you meet a venture capitalist in London, if they have over 100 million over management, it's a big deal. When I'm on the West Coast, like, I don't meet with people that have less than a billion, right? So here in London, the funds are tiny, which means if I go to a fund here in London and I say, I need to raise $50 million in my next round, that's half their fund. They're never going to be capable of doing that for a high-risk bet. Whereas when I go to the West Coast, or I go to New York, or even increasingly to Asia, it's not a problem whatsoever. Part of that is that money isn't put into the venture capital funds out of, like, pensions, government, you know, bank funds, et cetera, here in the UK. Part of that is that, quite frankly, the UK hasn't had a lot of big wins. So venture capitalists here in the UK haven't made their LPs that much money, which is why, you know, if I invest in venture capital funds, I would never invest in a London-based fund with one exception. They just haven't made the returns to justify raising these truly big funds that you need, which means that the UK economy is left in a really dangerous spot, particularly in terms of technology space, and I'm winding down to a conclusion on my little rant, because this gets back to confidence. There's no way that there's going to be huge outcomes in the UK that justify bigger funds without scale-up capital that gets you to the huge outcomes. And without market confidence, overseas investors on the West Coast and in New York and in Asia are not going to give people like me the capital that I need to give the UK a huge outcome. And that's why the market sentiment is incredibly dangerous.
Very, very briefly, very, very little of the activity in financial markets in the UK has got anything to do with providing new funding to non-financial companies. Rather more activity, but still only a minority, is about providing new funding to people to buy existing houses. This has been true for a very long time. It was the main commission of the main concern in many ways of the Macmillan Commission in the 1930s, the Radcliffe Commission in the 1950s, the Wilson Committee in the 1980s. So this is absolutely not a new issue. I think the reason it's not a new issue is it is always going to be extremely difficult to finance investment in new companies that are very risky and about which potential investors know not that much, and there's asymmetric information. So I think this is never going to be easy. My own view, for what it's worth, is it is hardly affected at all by Brexit.
Thank you. Next question, please.
My name is Vincenzo Scarpetta. I'm a senior policy analyst at Open Europe. My question is for Lindsey, actually. I have seen the Oliver Wyman report, and I actually have two short questions. The first one is, why did Oliver Wyman decide not to publish figures for the halfway scenario, which sounds eminently plausible to me, while the worst case and the best case look like a bit of outliers at the moment? And the second one is, when you assess the impact of a business directly related to the EU, did you also look into which passport specifically that's related to? Because banks, for example, use CRD4, but they also use MiFID. So is there that level of granularity in terms of which passport is responsible for what share of the revenue? Thank you.
To answer the first one, we didn't publish numbers in the second scenario for two primary reasons. One, it's quite difficult to quantify that middle scenario, particularly on the ecosystem impact. Really, the ecosystem impact, one could argue, is as large as in the high impact scenario, simply because firms will make decisions around the entire business, and lots of that is connected. So We wanted our report to be as robust as possible, and it's much more difficult to be robust in the way that we wanted to be about the middle numbers, and so we didn't publish them. And then the second one is, naturally, they're quite sensitive because it starts to unpick the potential negotiating strategy. So we thought it was inappropriate to start publishing numbers that we thought were in the national interest, and therefore we published the two bookends, and that's really what we were focused on. To answer the second question, which passports, the short answer is yes. We worked quite carefully with the various trade associations and also with lawyers, looking quite carefully in a very granular way about what bit of the business are we talking about. It's not just passporting, it's also equivalence and what's possible. They may be operating under a passport today, but could they do it under equivalence in future? And we also look quite carefully, particularly at the European corporate world, where you need a CRD 4 passport to do some of it, but actually you need a MiFID 2 passport to do the rest, but the two pieces are linked. And so we thought about that corporate value chain as a whole. So we did look in a very granular way at how the business was impacted. And obviously we didn't publish all that detail, but it has been made available to the City UK.
Yes, a gentleman over there.
Hello, my name is Charles Seaford from An Economy That Works. There is, most unfortunately, I think, a certain amount of schadenfreude going around that would be the response to some of the bad news we've heard today, particularly in parts of the country a long way from here. I suppose this question is more for Lindsey, but possibly for any member of the panel who want to answer it. Is there anything that, first of all, do you think that matters? Is that creating a barrier to getting what the finance sector wants? And secondly, if it does matter, is there anything that the finance sector can do, as opposed to say, to try and reduce that schadenfreude?
I do. So in terms of the first part of that question, certainly there are people who think, good ho, you got what was coming to you. But it's not a particularly rational outcome. Part of the work we did in the City UK work, and obviously a lot of the work the industry has done subsequently, is to try to be quite clear about the benefits of the financial services sector to end users of those financial services and all of the jobs. So the financial services and professional services sector in the UK employs 2.2 million people. That is a lot of people, and that is a lot of revenue for the exchequer. And so just for its own services, for the employment it has, that's a large number. And then obviously all of the end user benefits, so providing capital, as we've discussed on the panel, I won't go over the arguments again, providing risk management services to corporates, providing financing for home building, providing pensions investment, all of those things are really valuable things for the UK economy to have. And I think if you look beyond the rhetoric, and I'd hope as someone who works in this sector, we are moving beyond that and saying, well, how can financial services support the economy? And I think that's the argument that the industry needs to start to make, and indeed has made a lot of progress over the last few years in doing so. I'll hand it over to others. I'm sure you guys have a view.
Perhaps I might just offer a thought there, as I have the dubious pleasure of sitting on quite a few of the city steering groups that are trying to work out the way to respond to Brexit. And I really don't think there's a sort of "we told you so" sort of vibe going around. For a number of reasons, really. I mean, firstly, I think even the city is self-aware enough to know that wouldn't be a terribly good look coming 8 years after the worst financial crisis for 80 years. So I think, that, and, the focus is primarily on the political interface. And I've been struck, really, by just how focused both the politicians and, I think, business leaders are on the practical realities of getting their head around this very challenging situation and working out what to do next. And I think that applies both at an individual corporate level, for those insurance firms I talked about that are most affected by passporting. They are all, and they've said this publicly, in fairly advanced preparations for discussing what their different contingency arrangements are, for which places in Europe they might move some or all of their operations to. So that's clearly been a huge amount of work. And I think they're also, as Lindsay's drawn out, and Angus from the IA, these are businesses which are employing large numbers of people across the UK. It would be fantasy to imagine that all the employees of our respective sectors all voted to remain. If they had, I'm not sure we'd have got the result we had. So I think these are businesses that are conscious that they have talent to manage, they have people who work for them, that we live in a democracy where we have to respect the outcome of the vote, and where the significant practical challenges that face us as a result of that vote more than consume enough time, attention, and energy, not least because, as has been drawn out in several of the panels, panel contributions, the challenges that face us on something such as finding a way forward on equivalence, even though we start from a good position, navigating that in the context of a wider set of Brexit negotiations, these are pretty challenging conundrums to face, and I think they require all our energies.
Hi, my name's Anna Valero. I'm working on the LSEgrowth Commission Secretariat. I guess my question's for Lindsey, but also maybe Adam and David and anyone else. And it's kind of on the wider ecosystem aspect. So we have the finance sector ecosystem, but business services were a major source of productivity growth in the UK in the years up to the crisis, and are obviously very interlinked with finance, so accounting, consultancy, law. I was wondering if you have a view on how, if we lose the cluster or part of the cluster of financial services, how that will affect these other strong parts of our economy as well.
Yeah, let me pick that one up very quickly. I think in our report, for obvious reasons, being a professional services company ourselves, we didn't include any of the ecosystem impact in those. But they are a lot. The professional services sector is a large employer, but also the broader ecosystem impact, or perhaps the London effect. The ONS have multipliers, and for those of you interested, I'm sure you can look them up. But effectively, for jobs, the financial services sector, ONS multiplier, is for one job in the financial services sector, typically supports between 4 and 5 jobs elsewhere. And so we didn't want to catastrophize our report, but it's not rocket science to multiply 75,000 by 4 to 5. And then that would include the professional services piece. It also includes the nanny, the gardener, the pret sandwich maker, the cabs, the restaurants in London, the cultural elements around London, all of whom are go together to make the London cluster. And so that's the kind of multiplier that you might want to look at. Now, there are obvious issues with using that multiplier. It's not meant to be a replacement multiplier. You would think that person would find another job and continue to support that. But effectively, that's the kind of impact we're talking about if you believe those numbers.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, I mean, clearly, to the extent the UK, perhaps London specifically, ceases to be essential for the volume of international trade transactions, financial services trade transactions that it currently is, then that will impact the lawyers and the accountants. Although I think most of our work in practical terms is firms that are serving UK customers. It's an interesting fact, and it's in terms of the work I do. So day to day, I spend time with my financial services clients looking at the actual impact of Brexit under various scenarios on them and what they will be able to do in Europe. And one part of that process inevitably is where you put the big spreadsheet up, which is all of the other jurisdictions in Europe they might want to move to, parts of their business, maybe all of their business to, and you do the analysis around legal systems and the ecosystem of consultants and service industries and personal taxation, recruitment markets, etc. And then the one overwhelming result of doing that analysis and putting that in front of clients is they all say pretty much the same thing, which is, I don't want to go to any of those, actually. So the opportunity, the desire, I suppose, I'll pitch it, the desire to stay in the UK is very, very strong. I think there are all kinds of regulatory and legal details that will need to fall into place, both under the rules that exist currently and potentially the rules that get made in the future. But essentially, if we do this right, people are going to stay in the UK because that's the place they're comfortable and that's where the ecosystem is.
Thank you. I can see three questions. It's lady first.
Wendy Matthews. I'm a former government commercial lawyer and a biologist. And my question is really directed towards Grant Thornton, our doubled act. In particular, as regards environmental issues and so on, various economic measures are invariably proposed, things like feed-in tariffs, carbon pricing, guarantees, green investment banks and green bonds and so on. I was wondering, from your experience of your clients, which of those types of measure are going to be most acceptable and which are going to cause the greatest problems, and if so, you could see what measures could be taken to overcome those problems.
I guess the measures you've described are, I guess they're kind of around government incentives and the sort of regulatory environment for promoting green investment. I think where we've been increasingly looking, and I think it ties in with thinking about future financial services, is how do you best drive consumer behavior and make the market work to support investment. Slightly conscious of being on a table with Nick Stern, I think, as the foremost economist on climate change. I think Nick probably has far more to say than me. But I think our focus would be how can you, if you like, kind of consumerize that? How can you develop markets where people can, at a very simple level, people with their pensions, people with their savings, can take informed decisions about where they invest their money, whether that's then into green technology, or it might be into kind of large funds for technology scale-ups. But I sense that at the moment, technology can enable this. At the moment, markets can seem quite opaque to the individual investor. I think there's a great opportunity to kind of empower through greater information, through reporting on, and I think that's where the reporting on economic return, on environmental impact, and on social impact can help people take decisions of where they want to invest and how they can kind of therefore strengthen that purpose in markets.
We have in the UK been quite good for a while, up to last year, and then we started to oscillate. And I hope that with energy and industrial strategy more explicitly in what was BIS, that we, and with Greg Clark, who really understands these issues, we might go to a bit more stable areas. So I would emphasize, rather than picking just one of those things, I would emphasize the stability and credibility of policy. Just to underline transparency, at the request of Mark Carney, in his wearing his hat as chair of the Financial Stability Board, Bloomberg is about to, in this month, publish some protocols on reporting on the climate risk embodied in portfolios, and that kind of transparency, as you emphasised, will, I think, itself affect behaviour very strongly. But not for me. I'll have a question later on, but not for me to monopolise the story. Please, over there.
Hi, Tara Alice from McKinsey Global Institute. We've heard a lot about the issues, some of which are long-standing, some of which are exacerbated by Brexit, some of which are smaller, some of which are bigger, but quite little about solutions. Now, it's obvious that businesses need to get on with, managing their risks and comparative advantages and so on. And the government needs to get a reasonable deal on Brexit. But what other policy prescriptions do you think the government should be thinking about, or should they just keep everything as similar as possible to avoid any further uncertainty?
Yeah, I'm happy to take that, since I think I'm the only one directly running a business. I'm also the token American on this panel, so thank you. So I think there's a couple things the government can do. The first thing is to come out and take a firm position on what's going to happen to the hundreds of thousands of EU nationals that are currently working in the city. It's kind of an unacceptable situation that, as a leader of your firm, you can't go and tell the majority of your workforce what their long-term future looks like in the city that they've been living in many cases for a very long time. And so I think that in terms of quieting the market and restoring some of the confidence in London, that's probably the single biggest thing that can be done in the short term. The other thing is the government needs to quickly kind of lay out what their vision for what the British economy is going to look like post-Brexit. We can all work to whatever plan comes out, but there hasn't been a real communication from the government about what they want Britain to look like, what they want London to look like after Brexit occurs. Is London still going to be an international city of trade? Is it still going to be a financial hub? Are those things that the British government still interested in encouraging? But I think in the short term, they really need to settle the question of the EU nationals that are living here, because that'll remove a lot of the uncertainty. In the very long term, I'd love to see a merit-based immigration system. So this is one of the things that really can wind you up if you're running a high-talent business, which is that, you know, you'll see people come in on visas. What's my favorite? The exceptional talent visa. So I have a friend in London who just got a visa to move here from New York. He's a fashion designer. Not a world famous one, like just graduated from Parsons 2 years ago. Fashion designer. Took her 3 weeks to get the visa. I have someone who has a PhD in applied cryptography and just got the visa turned down, right? So apparently we have a shortage of fashion designers in London with 2 years experience, but we don't have a shortage of people with their PhD in applied cryptography, literally one in 30 people in the world with this level of talent. So there's something wrong with the system when it works that way. And if we want to continue to encourage talent, and if we're going to cut off our access to the large talent pool in Europe, which is the only thing that sort of means that our immigration system here in London works currently, is that we can sort of work around it by recruiting people with EU passports. If we no longer have that option, it really puts a ton of pressure on fixing the immigration system and moving sort of to a more merit-based approach.
May I add something?
Yes.
Thank you. As someone who works with many, many small businesses, I think one of our biggest needs is to be much clearer on what we mean by supporting innovation. We see this as being a key mantra that has been used a lot as part of the industrial strategy, which we, of course, have not yet seen. But as you are probably aware, this country has received billions of pounds in finance from Europe to support its innovation and, most importantly, support collaborative innovation, which has been so vital in this country. And we, although we have a very, very general statement that was made that a level of increase by 2020, I think it was 2 billion increase in spending on innovation, that is an incredibly broad term. And yet our opportunity to be one of the most innovative countries in the world, where we actually already have many, many opportunities among companies already sitting here, able to bring extremely innovative solutions to market, part of which does depend on finance, but depends on a much broader infrastructure and a much broader vision of innovation than I think has been currently set out here in the UK. So I think it's a real opportunity for us to help to shape that. But also, I do think we need here a lot more articulation of that from our government. Who are the players? Where is the money going? And what are the real opportunities, especially supporting the growth of the UK going forward?
I'll very quickly give the counterpoint to that. I'm on the other end of all the sort of government policy around encouraging innovation and skill spread and all this stuff. I think it's totally useless, huge waste of money. You know, we don't do these things in the United States, and I say we. I've never actually worked in America, but in the U.S. they don't do any of this stuff, and we have by far the most innovative, dynamic economy. We have all of the large tech companies in the U.S. over there. We don't do any of this innovation program stuff. What I wish the government would do with that money is take it from whatever collaboration programs are funding, whatever young entrepreneur programs are funding, and sink it entirely into great high-speed broadband, because it takes about 3 months to get a decent internet connection in an office in East London, and even when you get it, it doesn't really work. London has terrible internet, and so I wish that they would take all the money that they're spending on trying to encourage this sort of soft stuff and invest it into hard infrastructure, but they'll probably never do that because you don't get good news stories about digging up streets and putting in fiber optic cables. But anyway.
Yeah, you can, yes.
I just a picture of the different, I absolutely agree on the internet. I mean, taking this from a regulatory equivalence, which I think was part of the question perspective. So I work a lot on the opposite side of the table with the Financial Conduct Authority. The Prudential Regulation Authority said that the regulatory UK regulators are there all about equivalence. We will be more equivalent than anywhere else in Europe, I guarantee it, on every possible aspect of MiFID II and so on. So there's no question in my mind that we will, that the official policies, insofar as it's been articulated, is to drive through equivalence and then some. What that translates to, and I think whether that actually gives us equivalence, I don't know. I think, and I'm not a negotiation expert, clearly, but one thing I would like to see is the debate start to move on to, if equivalence is not on the table, what are some of the things we're going to do differently? Partly because I think that will start to give firms in the UK an idea of the kind of opportunities that might be available to them. And partly actually as a negotiating tactic, because I think the one aspect of equivalence that we kind of forget is that at some stage the EU might want us to be equivalent, because some of their wholesale capital markets, wholesale insurance businesses might end up coming to the UK if the UK is that much more desirable than where Europe ends up being. So I think for various reasons, I think that debate about what a non-equivalent regime might look like should start sooner rather than later.
I'd like to ask a question which is broader than, or goes beyond some of the issues we've been discussing, and is not purely a Brexit question, and that is infrastructure finance. The investment we need in our cities in the next 20 years or so will be very large. They're choked, they don't work, they're polluted. We're not the only cities in the world like that, but our cities are in many ways like that. This is a moment when technology is changing in a quite extraordinary way, so that the management of transport, for example, in cities now has opened up in extraordinary ways with the Internet of Things, managing cars, self-drive cars. You're not allowed to say driverless cars, but self-drive cars and so on, where the margins between public and private transport will be blurred. So from the point of view of opportunities and the point of view of deep, deep problems, we need big investments in our cities, and the finance associated with them will be very important. In the essence, it'll be very risky capital at the beginning, but also very long-term capital down the track. It poses very strong issues for the financial sector, but issues that we can't duck. And I wonder if any of you would like to comment on those.
Happy to have a stab, as it's a sort of fairly well trotted out thing at events like this, that the insurance and long-term savings sector should be funding all aspects of infrastructure. So perhaps if I set a challenge out for four areas why that isn't happening, certainly not to the degree it should do, and which we very sincerely hope the new Infrastructure Commission will get a handle on. Firstly, our regulatory system at the moment does not terribly well encourage pension funds in particular investing in infrastructure. They much prefer we invest in gilts than in roads or rail or any of the other things. The second is there's a huge pipeline challenge in delivering the projects at exactly the right point that the money is available. The third is there's considerable political risk around infrastructure investment in this country. Who'd honestly put their hand on their heart and say they're absolutely confident Heathrow is going to go ahead, or HS2, and what was all that about solar infrastructure in environmental technology? Didn't that all get scrapped after the last election? What about the Building Schools for the Future project, again canned in 2010? There is not a great track record in this country in long-term political commitment across the aisle to big infrastructure projects. And even with something like PFI that worked for quite a long time, we saw how quickly the political sort of mood around that changed, and suddenly the people who'd invested in those things were being branded as sort of robbers. Finally, the returns aren't good enough. If pension funds in particular to meet their duties to their investees, then the returns have to be a lot better than they currently are at the moment. And I think until we take a long, hard look at this, we're destined to forever lament that we both have poor infrastructure and not enough funding for it.
I take it that you're suggesting that this commission should have some ideas?
some ideas and I think a degree of political backing to try and crack some of these traditional problems. Otherwise, we're destined to go through a fairly tedious cycle of every 2 or 3 years Treasury ministers having a fresh infrastructure initiative, which doesn't actually ever seem to sort of go anywhere, which I think we've all lived through quite a bit over the last 15 years or so.
Thank you. I'm just going to take two questions and take them together, and then we'll have to close. So I see one lady at the back, one question, and this gentleman just near you for the second one.
My name is Ivana Borovic. I'm working here at the Growth Commission team, as well as I'm working on innovation policy at the World Bank in Washington, D.C. So my question is, because you represent different subsectors of financial services, how would you define failure or success of Brexit negotiations? And the second question is about London as a hub for entrepreneurship, for finance. Is it more towards EU needs London or London needs EU? How you see the connection? Who are you? What would you say in that? Thank you.
And the gentleman just there, and then I'll put it for them.
Matt Luff, ONS. There's been quite a lot of talk about Brexit means Brexit, and that, you know, this is going to occur. I just wondered whether you had any thoughts on what the impact of, say, a second referendum would have, and whether any of the kind of areas of the financial services, whether it's insurers or actual businesses, would have a positive or negative reaction to that occurring.
So who'd like to pick up on those?
I can make a start, as I
please, think. Please.
Said much. I mean, on the first question, failure and success, I mean, for us, it's just measuring our objectives. I mean, we've talked a lot on talent. It's going to be pretty easy to measure success, a successful outcome on talent, and that goes beyond Brexit, of course. Market access, failure, success is measurable. If our route to market is impaired substantially from what now happens, that's a failure for us. And just on who needs who more, frankly, that's not clear. The consultants are starting work on that. I know Ernst & Young are already looking at trying to put some numbers on the need from EU corporates, EU institutions, for the London Financial Centre. That's proving quite difficult, not least because it's quite political. EU governments don't like their major corporates arming the UK in these negotiations. I'll leave it at that.
So failure or success, I think, is going to be really hard to define because there's so many different verticals that you can look at. I think in terms of, for us as a firm, what success will look like is continued access to European talent. So for us to continue investing in London, to not shift more and more of our operations to New York, which is what we've done post-Brexit, we'll have to know that we're going to have long-term access to European talent. So that's success, failure for us. On who needs who more, I think that a long time ago, I used to be an economist, and I basically figured out that I could never figure things out in advance. Which is terrible discipline. But I think in the short term, the EU needs London more. So in the very short term, so much of how the EU runs and how the European economy works routes through London, that in the short term, I think the EU probably needs London more. In the long term, and I'm talking about maybe a 10-year horizon here, I think London needs the EU much more than the other way around. And so I think the danger here is that in the short term, we figure out that maybe London didn't need the EU as much as it thought it did. Maybe the EU needs us more. But what we'll find out very slowly over a 10-year period is that actually London needed the EU more. But by that point, it'll already be too late. And that's what makes it quite dangerous. On the second referendum question, I gave up my ability to predict both British and American politics this year. So I have no idea. I know a second referendum, I'd view it as probably a bad sign because it's uncertainty. And so I think, you know, there was a referendum. They're sorting out whether or not it was legally binding now. But a second referendum is probably just more uncertainty in the market.
So I had a slightly flippant remark on a second referendum. Obviously, it depends what the question would be, and it's very far from clear what the question could be. But it seems to me that one way to ensure that the result is more likely to be leave again is to put lots of stress on how the financial sector in London really needs us to remain. That just does not play well in the UK, for most people who vote in the UK. And it may not be unconnected. It may not be unconnected to the fact, once again, that a lot of what goes on in London actually is not much to do with providing finance to households and companies in the UK.
Yeah, if I can just build on that point. For me, the point of a second referendum is one that sounds appealing, sat in the middle of London's intelligentsia bubble, but is not the reality as soon as you leave that bubble, and indeed is to misunderstand where we are as a country and where we are as a Western system of democracy. And until you really understand that, you are not going to solve the problems that your ordinary people think we have. And I think that's where we need some brain power, not into figuring out how we get to a second referendum, but how we solve those societal issues and attitudes that led us to this point. Whether or not you believe in Brexit is not the point, but it's how divided we are as a country. And until you solve that, that question just misses the point, I'm afraid.
The perspective of our clients and I think across financial services, you know, I think it's maybe stating the obvious, say success, ultimate success would be securing passporting and securing access to talent. But I think people are realistic about whether that's achievable. I would say their fallback is simply having certainty as soon as possible as to what the future will look like, and then time for that transition. So being really clear very quickly about just what the deal, what the outcome will be, and then having a longer transitional period to manage that. I guess the other sort of success factor for those who are doing more long-term thinking would be success looks like a deal that guarantees maintenance of the UK as fintech centre. It's the one area where we really lead in the world at the moment. It's the point that's where the future lies, and the focus on how we really capture the aspects of that will give us success in the long term. Second referendum, I think kind of irrelevant to business. I don't think most firms will wait the 2 years it might take to have a second referendum. If we assume that's right at the end of the deal, people are looking to take decisions sooner rather than later. They're already kind of doing scenario planning. I just don't think businesses will hang around for the uncertainty that a second referendum will create.
I feel I've got to chip in as well. Successful. So I'm firmly of the view, at a very practical level, in terms of the current rule set, that hard Brexit's not a disaster, it's actually quite manageable. Primarily because within the EU construct, there's a whole load of national rules, so the national flexibility that the different countries can offer, which means that we can park a gateway, two people and a dog in Dublin, and do a bunch of the things we would have done otherwise. That's a slight exaggeration, but there is a lot of national flexibility on the table. So it's less about the current state rules. Success for me in negotiation is more about having a mechanism, a process going forward that gives us some influence over potentially, but certainly some knowledge of where the regulation of the rules in the EU may go in the future, whether some of those loopholes are going to get closed down. So that's for me the big risk factor. Does the EU need us? I mean, the EU needs access to global financial centres. If it doesn't need the EU, in London, London's off the table, then it needs New York, then it needs Hong Kong or Singapore or Shanghai even. There'll be quite a long way down the list before you get to another European capital, which it needs. It needs access to global financial muscle, and at the moment London is one of those places. As for the second referendum, I'd rather not, I think. I'd have to get all my signage back out of the garage and put it on the front of the house, and the neighbours would get upset, so I'll pass.
Thank you all very much. I'm not going to try to sum up it. For those of us who are going to write the next round of the Growth Commission, it's been very helpful. We've heard much about talent, much about regulation and passporting, much about uncertainty around the Brexit story, and we've heard much about very long-standing problems of scaling up, and helping, having a financial system that's much better at helping to scale up. And we've heard other long-standing issues around our inability to handle infrastructure very well. Those, I'm sure, will stay with us, but it's our duty to try to be creative about all those things. We've learned enormously from all of you. Could you join me in thanking those who spoke? It's sort of tremendous. Thank you.